historian Xenophon said, agriculture is the best of all occupations or arts by which men procure the means of living. It's good to have you join us on this week's episode of Agro On TV. I'm Rukewa Ikewenu. We have interesting topics on our segments today. Be a part of the show by sending your comments to our social media platforms displayed on your screen. We will be back after this timeout. Worried about further increase in food prices in 2017? Fear not, as the Minister of Agriculture and Rural Development, Chief Audobe, has allayed such fear. Details of this and more are what we have for you on the polls.
Contrary to reports making the rounds that the prices of food commodities will soar in 2017, the Minister of Agriculture and Rural Development, Aldo Ogwe, has refuted the claim, stating that efforts to step up food production in the country are already in motion, which would lead to drop in prices. Ogwe, who also assured Nigerians that there won't be famine in the country, made this statement while addressing newsmen in Abuja at the 11th edition of the African Economic Conference. According to him, the prices of food will fall once production reach a level where those who want to exploit can no longer do so because there's so much available everywhere.
Agribusiness owners in Nigeria have been enjoined to maximize digital opportunities in agriculture. This call was made at the Discovery Day Lagos 2016 held at the Intercontinental Hotel Lagos. The event was jointly organized by Nigeria's premier location intelligence firm, Polaris Digitech Limited, as well as the world's leading provider of high-resolution health imagery, data and analysis, Digital Globe Incorporated. Highlights were made on the value of satellite imagery and data analytics in transforming the agricultural sector and developing agribusiness in Nigeria. The event was attended by public-private functionaries who are concerned with ramping up on agriculture in their states to address food security, youth unemployment, and revenue generation.
Food is still expensive, and it's because we are not optimizing farming with satellite technology in Nigeria. But with this now, I believe that farmers should take advantage. Come to us, we'll provide information about their farm, the health of what they are planting, and the likely yield.
Now it's easier to sit down, map out where you think you can get a high yield for your crop production. So, though it may be costly in terms of getting the platform to use now, but it's a sure bet for revolutionizing the agri sector in terms of crop farming, animal husbandry, to even stop the tide between the herdsmen and the crop farmers.
It's very serious. Government begins to look at how we can apply what we've learned here to taking agriculture to the next level, basically.
High Hill Agribusiness Development Center is an agricultural empowerment training center located in Abeokuta, Ogun State. I had a chat with the CEO, Shola Adeniyi. Enjoy the chat. Our guest on Talk Time today is Shola Adeniyi, who is the CEO, High Hill Agribusiness Development Center. Good to have you, sir.
Thank you, madam.
Can you tell us what exactly you do?
Yeah, here in High Hill Agribusiness Development Center, it's actually an empowerment, agri-empowerment training center. What we do majorly is to empower people practically about things they can do around agriculture and the business of agriculture, which is agribusiness.
About training, a lot of people are interested in agriculture, starting with a small-scale agribusiness. What can you say about small-scale agribusiness in Nigeria today?
Also, it's something that is highly welcome. Like, almost every day I do training, I talk to people that if you want to really strike it in agriculture, you need to start looking at the agribusiness aspect of it. That is the business of agri itself. Everyone should not go into the bush to say they want to go into the production in terms of farming. Some people should be in other value chain. A lot of it is massive. You understand the logistics, the processing, the packaging, marketing. There are a lot of things that each and every one of us can do. And how do you know what you want, you can do, and how do I know what I can do? We start looking at our personality, the kind of time we have, the kind of fund we have. These are the things that will determine part of the value chain that you are going to key into. So you need to know yourself. If, for example, I see that most ladies don't like anything that crawl, let's say snake, worm, and stuff like that. So for somebody that doesn't like that, he or she might not be able to do things or produce something that will bring that kind of thing. So you should know your personality. Are you working somewhere you want to do agric as part-time, or probably you want to go full-time? So you really need to understand your personality, do your SWOT analysis, and this will help you to know what to do. But by and large, agribusiness is super.
A lot of people see agribusiness as lucrative, quite all right,
okay, yeah.
But they have issues with funding. How can people go about funding in agribusiness?
Well, I'm of the school of thought that you start with what you have. I'm sorry if I'm saying this, especially if you are starting. Having showed the passion or the interest that you want to go into agribusiness, then the next thing is you need to seek for information. That is the technical know-how. You need to really understand what you want to do. Then you need to start small. And I say, why play with other people's money? You do business with other people's money. So if you are starting small, what you are supposed to do is start with your own fund, then you can now expand with loan and any kind of fund that is coming your way. So fund has always been issue with every sector, but you need to start with what you have. Then this is when people can now key into you. That is when you have history. That is when you start having things to show as collateral. You know, Nigeria being where it is, you need to start with your own. Then people can start helping you out because they can see result in what you're doing. But if you are waiting for a loan or for any fund somewhere around agriculture, you're going to wait for a quite long time. So use what you have to get what you want.
Most of the small-scale agribusiness owners complain of lack of mechanized farming in Nigeria. What can you say about this?
Yeah, I think we were discussing online yesterday, and I was telling someone that, do you know that we're like almost 15, 20 years, you know, backward agribusiness-wise to like the likes of Kenya, even unfortunately to the likes of Rwanda and Uganda, and almost 50 to the developed country. You see, in this local government where I am, we have less than 20 tractors. So you see everybody doing an acre of land and you think you're a farmer. That is not. If you want to talk about commercial, you start looking at anything from 10 hectares and above. And you cannot use cutlass to do this kind of thing. So the basic thing that needs to, from your land preparation, your land clearing, your land preparation and some other things, we don't even have them. So the issue of going mechanized is still a bit hard. But we are scaling. You know, we are scaling out of this issue. Some private people are bringing in these things, and some people are keen to it one way or the other. And this is another aspect that you and I, or an intending agropreneur, can key into. You can actually come into machine supply, lease, renting. That's why I say the value chain is massive. So, but unfortunately, government is not really looking at this. There are some local government that they don't even have one tractor to do plowing or hiring. So you can imagine how hard it's going to be for the farmer there to escalate and do a lot of things.
Moving forward about this mechanized farming issue, since the government is not looking at it, how can they look at it? What exactly can they do? Because they are needed in this.
It's the private, you know, investors that can really help us in this country. But how will they help us when the environment is not conducive? When you start getting government that has policy that is somehow sorting here and there. So people are afraid of this country to bring, but it's unfortunate.
Youth are needed mostly in agriculture right
now. Of course, especially now.
Yes, especially now, because we're talking about move diversifying the economy, focusing on agriculture.
Yes.
You are into youth development.
Yes.
How is agriculture really receptive to the youth? Are they really getting involved?
I will give it to the past government and the present government, especially the past minister of agriculture in the person of Dr. Adesina, actually make agriculture a bit attractive. You understand, I will tell you that the inquiry is massive and a lot of youth have actually come. You can see at the background, I have almost 20 of them presently on my 3-month program. On the 3-month farm manager program, is a lot of, recently we do have a lot of people. Sometimes we have people, 50 people that we enroll. Then what we do is to like scale them based on why or the reason or their statement letter. Why are you coming for agri? So we like scale them up because our capacity, because it includes accommodation, it's a practical thing. This is our training center. Then we have a bigger farm.
So they move from the training center in the morning, they go to the bigger farm, they come around 4 p.m., they do the evening job in the training center, they go back to their hostel. So a lot of people are actually showing interest. Almost every weekend we talk to different youth. Like this Saturday, we're also going to be in Lagos talking to another group of youth. So youths are actually coming into agriculture because a lot of people are making, you know, attractive. What I do in the area of agribusiness is I make sure that I teach them the in-depth knowledge about it. It's not about the farming thing. There's little to what you can do. You can get people to do this for you, but how do you turn it to money? How do you add value? Then how do you show forth that anywhere you are, you can be respected and say, so wow, I'm an agriculturist, or I'm a farmer, or I'm an agropreneur, whatever grammar you want to use for it. So you have to look good, and you need to understand what you are doing. So before you go into it, try and understand. It's like every other business. You're going to pay your price.
What are the challenges being faced by you in this business of plantain and banana farming?
Generally, the major thing is irrigation. You understand? Unfortunately, you know, we don't get lands from the government. We buy lands from different zones and everything. And even if you get from the government, there's no river that you can like pump your water from. So you need to sink your borehole. Then irrigation kit is damn too expensive. The best irrigation for things like this is drip irrigation, but it's the one of the most expensive irrigation system. Now, the other one is this that you can see, that's a spray tube irrigation system. I brought in spray tube irrigation system in the country, and it's working, it's doing well. But the issue is, it breeds kind of weeds, unlike drip. Drip is a precise irrigation system. It goes to where you are sending. But this is just blowing water like rain, so you have to walk around weed. That's why we are now doing mulching, training different people. Like, okay, this is how to mulch your farm and you still get water. The major problem in this business is water, irrigation. How do you put water on your plantain or your banana farm, most especially during dry season, and which we are going to have for like 4 or 5 months sometimes. Last year is almost 5 or 6 months, depends on the state where you're living. That's the major thing. The other thing is, if you know the basic nutrient that it needs, then give it, you understand? That's it. But the major thing is the issue of irrigation.
You talked earlier about government policies. What particular policies of government are really disturbing your farming?
Let me now ask another question. Sorry for this. What policy do we have in place that is supporting agriculture? Development in Nigeria, what policy? You know, the major thing that like distracts or sent away potential investors is, like I said, some uncertain policy. This year alone, we've gotten like almost 2 to 3 different information around ban on importation of rice through the road border and these. You say, okay, they, we are banning. No, we are opening it for some. So, you know, for those that want to invest, it was like they will go back and say, okay, what is going on here? Where am I supposed to come in? One of the policy or one of the thing I need, presently the body language of the government is a bit positive towards agriculture. That's why everybody is going to it. But it needs to be sustainable in the area of creating a conducive environment. When I say a conducive environment, one of it is this buying back thing. Most farmers don't even know where to sell their produce to. Most farmers still operate on markets that have been in existence for almost 20, 30, 40, 50 years, created by our great grandfathers. For example, if anybody is doing anything, especially those that jump into it, is doing anything around Ogun, Osun, Oyo, they are moving everything back to Lagos, they might to market and some other part of it. So government needs to start looking at, how do you offtake these things from this farmer? Do you bring investors that are using these things as raw material and then start training your people to produce for them? You know, it has to be a business that you are sure of. You should know the input and the output. Okay, if I'm doing an acre of plantain, what am I likely to get? Based on those that are buying, what is the benchmark? Okay, per kg, they are buying, so let's say we are buying at 100 naira per kg. Now, for my farm, for a 1 acre farm using 2 meter by 2 meter, you can do, it depends on how your terrain and everything. Let's say, for reckless imagination, so you are putting 800 suckers. Now, a sucker will come forth and produce a bunch. Now, let's say the bunch is just 10 kg. 10 kg multiplied by 100 naira, that's 1,000 naira. 1,000 naira multiplied by 800 bunch, 800 suckers, or let's say trees of plantain, that is 800,000 naira. Do you understand that? You know, it's easy to calculate now. That is that. Now, what are the inputs? The cost of the land, you can't get it in a year. But you can imagine if the land is being given to you by the government at a very subsidized amount of money compared to somebody that is buying an acre for 500,000 naira. That is one. If you have a kind of water system and you have been given irrigation system at a very reduced rate, you know, you also work that into it. The environment for those that are working on the government lands and everything, all things being equal, will be more conducive than some of us that are working on Omonile land. I hope you are getting it now. So then you start seeing reduction in the cost of this produce. The price will start coming down because there's sustainability. Then people can produce under a conducive environment. Another funny thing is, after this toiling, struggling and everything we are doing, we will still compete with the produce that are coming from other Africa countries. If you go to some of our malls, you see plantain coming from Tanzania, banana coming from Tanzania, you see this coming from this place, this coming, and our own is not eating that mall. So the challenge is, so the government needs, I said government is like a father. You understand? You need to create a conducive environment for your child to grow. So agri-sector is a child. Each other sector is a child. So the government needs to produce a conducive environment. I'm not asking for good roads to my farm because they are not even fixing the roads to the cities. I'm not asking for electricity because it's like a dream that will not come true. What I'm saying is, I don't want to come out after all this issue and start competing with somebody that is getting government facility, grant or loan from another African and start competing with them in my own market.
Thank you. You've heard it. Let's push Nigeria forward. Our guest has been Shola Adeniyi, who is the CEO, High Hill Agribusiness Development Center. Thank you very much.
Madam, thank you.
I am Aisha Abubakar, Minister of State Industry, Trade and Investment.
My name is Olusegun Awolowo.
I'm Govin from Premium Aquaculture.
My name is Chief Eric Umofia, the King of Tomato.
My name is Iyalode Alaba Lawson, the first deputy national president of NASIMA.
And you are watching Agro Nigeria TV.
Keep watching Agro On TV.
We are watching Agro TV.
The future of this great country lies in our hands. Women, come out now. Join us at Agro On TV.
On AgroStyle this week, Honorable Munir Danagundi, a member of the House of Representatives Committee on Agriculture, is our guest. Let's watch as it takes us through the plans of the Green Chambers on agriculture.
My name is Munir Babadanagundi. I'm a member of Nigeria's House of Reps Committee on Agriculture. Yes, it is true that we have many intervention points that cater for agriculture, but people find it difficult to access the fund due to bottlenecks or conditions attached to it. And then, as members of the House of Reps, we are even looking at the interventions given by the Central Bank and other agencies to see how we can make it better for Nigerians to access so that we can be able to develop our agribusiness entrepreneurs, SMEs and what have you. So we are looking at that to remove the bottlenecks by reenacting the laws where necessary or by making sure that the government should bring other ways of intervention in terms of giving them this funds through our development partners, like I know of one that is being under consideration by African Development Bank, whereby the states will access who about 1,000 graduates who have no jobs to key in agriculture and then be funded under the same scheme, maybe with a lot of money, lands they are thinking between $30,000 to $50,000 per graduate after incubation of 6 months or 9 months. So it's still under consideration, and we hope at the end of the day each state can access this money to cater at least for 1,000 graduates. Some of the dams belong to the local government, some belong to the state, some belong to the federal. Like in my own state, Kano State, we are looking for anybody that will come and take some of the dams in terms of fisheries, in terms of agriculture, as I'm talking to you. So it all depends on the state or the governor, how he wants to create opportunities in his state. Because the federal cannot legislate on the state, then we cannot legislate on the local government. So these are issues which must be centered or tailored to the states for further consultation. But as I said, my state has about 22 dams which are ready for use, and anybody interested in acquiring these dams, we are ready to give them or to partner with them to see that a lot of hectares are put into production. You see, the proposal of budgetary provisions come from the executive. And you see, as an emerging democracy, we are still battling to even understand what role each person plays, each arm of government plays. When we try to look at the budget and upgrade it, they will say we are padding the budget. When we try to see that sectors like agriculture is given its due preference, considering Nigeria is a signatory to Maputo Declaration 2003, that all countries must make sure agriculture at least budget 10% of its capital on agriculture, so that we can have progress in our own country, which to me is very important. And not until the executive understands this, then we still have some issues to sort out.
If you watch that match, you see the message, this guy don't serve
here. Are you blind? Can't you see?
Mama Sunday, what's the matter?
Mama Sunday, answer us now. Who has offended you today? Have they sent Sunday away from school?
Look at my son. He just came back from school and there is nothing for him to eat for lunch. I was hoping that he would have had some food in school as promised by the current administration during their campaign. I am tired of the promise and faith of this government, especially on this school feeding policy.
Is that why you are worried? Forget about these politicians for now. This school feeding policy to me is a prank.
Even if it's not a prank, Uche, of what benefit is it to us? What do we stand to gain from it? School feeding what?
Let me tell you one thing. All these things, all these are promises. It's just a hoax. Look. Business as usual, that's the main thing. First of all, they will provoke the empathy of the masses. Then you now take advantage of their weakness to gain votes. Next to me, all this policy is not in the light of day.
Guys, listen to me. This government is clueless.
Clueless?
They don't know what to do at all. They are very clueless.
Very, very clueless.
They touch their
priority. Adamu Uche! Yes, Yummy, this is wrong. You people cannot be correct.
The homegrown school feeding program is a policy of this government that is aimed at providing primary school age children like Sunday with one balanced meal a day, which will enable them grow properly and have their brains properly formed. That way, you can have professors coming from children like this. Because if a child like this is getting a balanced diet, his health will be protected. So we will not be having issues of children dying and children having problems and government spending money on hospital bills. But my people, the homegrown school feeding program of this government is one that we all must support in order for it to succeed.
Nigerians have started reacting to the National Assembly's efforts to make the federal government ensure quality food is available to all through the Food Security Bill. That's what we have for you on Street Vibes today.
I think it's a welcome development. At least the country is concerned about its citizen, about the well-being of its citizen. That things they want everybody to be healthy, and at the same time, they should eat well. So quality food is what we want in this country. So I would thank the government for bringing such initiative to the country right now. So I think this is a welcome development.
I feel that there should be more control and monitoring as per companies that processed food, are processed food, either raw, either the canned foods. And with that, I think we are heading somewhere very good.
To me, it's a good development because if you look at the quality of food being served or being sold in our market in Nigeria today, we discover that most of them are not good for human consumption. All manner of products are being imported, and you know, coupled with the hardship in the economy, you know, most of those things being imported today, they are not. All these carbonated foods, some of them, they are not good for human consumption. And I believe that if the necessary government agencies like NAFDAC and the other agencies in charge of food item in Nigeria, both at the federal and state level, it will go a long way.
For the first time, our government will look into the food we eat, because the food intake matters a lot. It helps the country, the people, to live in good health or to stay healthier. But the thing is, a lot of farmers, they want quick sales of their product. Like some farmers, they use cabbage for plantain to ripe, for some fruits to get ripe so that they can sell on time. Because when they use cabbage, the plantain looks very fresh. It looks good looking. 1 or 2 days after that, it starts decaying, of which is not good. I think they should regulate the, after the bill, they should regulate it and ensure all those things are looked into.
Thank you for being a part of today's program. In case you missed any part of the show, you can always catch up on YouTube, as each episode of Agro On TV is available for your view. Share your comments and suggestions on our social media platforms displayed on your screen. You can advertise your products and services on this show, as well as contact us for the management of agricultural projects and events. Until next week, I remain your host, Rukebe Ikewinu. Think growth, think agriculture. Bye for now.